first, can you speak louder?
Yes, I can try. Just to remind me if I don't.
Please. Right big.
Huh?
Okay, right big.
Right large, okay.
Big.
So this, what I'm going to talk about is the joint work with my student, South Carolina. So if people have money to pay mathematicians on a temporary basis, we as a mathematician
they very much like to be paid on a temporary basis. Do mathematics.
And hopefully what I say is interesting enough to make you think about that.
So I could start motivating this by one of two ways. In my notes, I start the other way, so I'm going to try and reverse that. So the word non-commutative is a bit of a loaded term because I don't think there's a general framework for which you can say something like non-commutative algebraic. General agreed upon framework. This means different things to different people. Although people in this room maybe teach each other things like that. What I'm going to do is, we thought it was a special subcase of that. And it's about 20 years old. This is non-commutative. What I'm going to talk about is non-commutative projective geometry. And I think the idea is predates a bit, but its development due to our understanding, I think in the mid-90s. Please correct me if I say things that are not true, especially with regards to
and the babies.
And the babies, really?
Yeah.
Oh wow, okay. So there we go.
These for the classes I teach, I turn this into a game by which they get points if they can catch me making a mistake. And then I can pretend like those mistakes were all planned. Right? So I don't really make mistakes unless they're done with it. Okay. What's the basic ingredient for this? The basic ingredient for this is so K will only be a field, and A will be a connected graded scale. So connected just means there's nothing in negative degrees, and the degree zero piece is the field. Okay, so, AI is zero for negative degrees, and this guy is just, maybe it should really call it connected graded, because I didn't know it's graded before I can say it's connected, but whatever. And then, of course, I multiply things in degree I multiply things in degree j, I end up with things in degree I plus j. So, maybe your favorite example is, polynomials in n plus 1 variables where I've assigned weights 1 to everything. Another example that's naturally graded that we always deal with but never really think about explicitly, at least I don't, is just a free algebra generated by an alphabet aside all weights 1. Okay? That's my notation for the free algebra. Faces. It's okay, question, ask a question. That way, the minuscule amount of material I have will expand. Okay, so how do we expect to do any kind of geometry related to something like this? So, the inspiration goes back to Sayre's famous result. Say, x projective over a field. And then we can take A, this to be, either you can say it's defined by a homogeneous ideal or sections. Then you can study graded modules up to torsion. So I have the category torsion guys. So this is this full subcategory of modulus M such that, maybe T, such that they're locally
my deal.
So. For such a thing, I always have one obvious, two-sided maximal ideal, which those are strictly possible. Okay. And then this guy here is just those that are locally annihilated by some polynomials. And you can form, this is just notation for the quotient category. Grade modulus, modulo. And what Sayre's result says is that, so this is, in general, and then back to the example, Sayre's result just says that quasi coherent sheaves on the projective Cmax is equivalent to the category quasi curve of this connected group of the algebra. Okay. This is not, I mean, a great result, but it's also quite old, so in some sense internalized in our collective memory and becomes familiar. Okay? So what Art and Jim did was they took this as very familiar when we think about non-commutative varieties, they took this as a starting definition now, what we want as a non-commutative predicate. So an abelian category is realized by starting with connected degree of alpha and localizing at modulus annihilated by this maximum degree. So the non-commutative scheme associated to A, which is called X of A, is the category. Or more precisely, you want to think about some phantom geometric object whose coherent sheaves, category of coherent sheaves is this category of category. Graded modulus, modulo torsion. All right, so why should we care? So,
did you make finiteness assumptions on the graded algebra?
Not at the moment. There, to say anything reasonable, yes. We're going to have to make some finite assumptions. Finiteness is something for long. But you can write definitions. Say nothing. So, examples, right? So, commutative, in particular, the examples I have on the board here, I can take polynomials, I can take free algebra with its natural gradient. Another thing that I can do that's maybe less large than this, closer to this in spirit, is I can think about twisting my commutativity relations in my variables by a matrix. So I can take the matrix, and I can take the free algebra, and then quotient by. It was generated by setting xj equal to xi times xj equal to xj times xi up to a factor from the mixer. Okay. Sometimes these are, I mean, this terminology is also something that I found is a bit overused. Non-commutative projective spaces. So I suspect I should only use interior boards, not the last two.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do I need it? I don't know if I need it.
If you want neutral projective space.
Yeah, you could see it.
Okay. Is it really neutral?
I mean, what if you want a neutral projective space?
It is.
I was going to
the whole last measure.
Oh, okay, yeah. Oh, yeah. Sorry. And I appreciate it. You people point out.
So many points.
Okay.
Now, instead of composing these quadratic relations, we compose some different quadratic relations. So, A yz plus B zy plus C x squared. A xz plus B zx plus C y squared. And A xy plus B yx plus C. We've seen these explicitly in this work of Luke and Sokoff and Olof. In this setting, the non-commutative deformations, they pop up in mirror symmetry via non-exact deformations of the symplectic structure. Told the story of P2. Sometimes they also give a solution to an inverse moduli problem. Right? I have a moduli space, I do something to it. I want to realize the output is a moduli space of something else. Right? That's a powerful tool, because once I know it's a moduli space, then I have access to a lot of other things that I want to deal with. So
So you can look at commutative deformations of moduli spaces and realize them as moduli of non-commutative, not of things on non-commutative pairs. Hilbert schemes on P2. This is something that's done by Nevins and stuff. And then along those lines, well, in the same generality of that, at least for non-commutative projective surfaces, an obvious question to look at. Bridge of moduli, right? Surface casings are what we have the most success in constructing bridge and stability conditions. These guys are pretty closely related, right, to things we want to think about as surfaces, at least these non-commutative P2s. I think from this list, you can feel somewhat confident that these do have some bearing on your symmetry. In particular, since we've already done this business of replacing a space by a category, it would behoove us, in situations like this, or looking at homological symmetry, to gain a better understanding of what we want to understand. Very big. We want to understand the drive category of one of these non-commutative projective systems. So when I say drive category, it's the unbounded all-chain complexes. Okay. And when I say understand this, well, you know, you think back of all the parts. Okay, let's say X is commutative. Okay. And you know, you don't like this?
It's fine.
It's okay. I'm just used to teaching calculus, so I have to stop. And people, it's just, sorry, it's a habit. I'll try not to listen to it. So at the basic level, what I want to do here is, well, if I think about, say, smooth projective drawing, right? What does it mean to understand the drawing? Again, it's a very vague question. What tools do I have to understand the drive category, right? So, X, and let's say Y now, for simplicity of smooth and projective. The most natural way to relate one drive category to the other is to construct a geometric function, right? So if you're given some P, complex on the product, you get some integral transform from dx dy. Let me just, I'm sure everyone knows what this is, but just to set out some notation, this comes from everything derived that I write, P tensor. Okay, pulling back, tensoring, and integrating. Right? It's a familiar story to everyone. And then you ask, well, in what sense is this the right place to look for maps between two such things? Well, one way to justify that is to ask where equivalences come from. Right? If I have an equivalence between two drive categories, I want to know what type of form that equivalence could take. So
well known internalized result. A and B are just failed for us because that's the setting we're in for the moment. Maria tells us that if I look at, instead of the drive category, look at the category of modules, I have equivalence, if and only if, see if just of this form, but you can write it simply as there exists a bimodule P such that P is projected as an A module, and I look at Tom B. So it generates A sub, and then it's fully fitted
quantity.
Oh, fine, yeah, sorry. That's in my thing.
Thank you. Also, the red total should be the zero, it's in the country, but it should be included. Otherwise.
Yeah, you're right. There's a nice way to state this.
Everything can be covered by the red sum of quantities.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I don't know why I think I'm recycling this for a talk. I should just say, if we're going to put on some particular things, right? I'm just waiting to break down. Thank you. Okay. What is this result saying? It says that a generic equivalence, general, abstract, whatever, equivalence, that's some functor between the Boolean categories, actually comes from something a bit more tied to A and B. You have bimodule, you're tensoring with it, that gives you B. Okay? You can upgrade this, keeping non-commutative, okay, well, let me just remark, first of all. A and B commutative implies A is isomorphic to B. We get end of one because it's an identity functor for a quick proof of the state. So, non-commutivity, you can take matrices on something as an obvious choice, but there's something new happening here for non-commutative things. For commutative things, not so much. Ricard says, similar statement. So there exists a P in the drive category of bimodules. Like that. Tensor of P. Statement too, but again, this is a matter of questions. So,
again, if A and B are commutative, this implies A is less than one. So nothing exciting is happening in the commutative realm in these two statements. So to get some excitement, we want to globalize these ideas, right? We all know how to globalize commutative. So X and Y are smooth, projective over K, then the result of a law can be very much thought of in these lines. And if I have an equivalence of derived categories, if and only if I have some P, such that this guy isn't. In fact, this is one of those situations where you can say that the equivalence is geometric. And you can go even further, you can say erase. I don't know the full extent. Can you do it for any quasi-compact and quasi-separated scheme that there exists an equivalence? Or is it?
There's a paper by Kalimak and Stellari.
I'm sorry to be on the spot. I should look this up before. Right. So I think you need an existence of an ample sequence or something like this?
Yes.
Okay. So let's say just quasi projection. And relaxing any kind of singularities. Then work with one to all tell us the same statement. In this case, right? And well, it secretly imports this internal hom, maybe not so secretly, but the way I presented this. Cohen's internal hom. First, you show an equivalence list to a quasi-functor, and then you say, okay, well, that's the right structure we need. And we can realize any sort of quasi-functor as something coming from objects.
Didn't you also prove that?
Huh?
Didn't you also prove that?
Did I?
You.
Did I?
Pretty much. That's there.
I don't know, did I?
Yes.
Okay.
I didn't want to say it was King Cooper.
Huh?
I didn't want to say it was King Cooper.
Oh, did you prove it?
No, you.
I'm on camera. My grandma got Alzheimer's, but she was in her late 70s. It was pretty terrible. And so my dad was always afraid of these little things that you do when you get older. So he was very happy when I came home when I was in my late 20s and I started putting the milk back into the cupboard, the cereal into the fridge, because he felt like, oh, it's just, it's nothing serious. It's just general absent-mindedness, like thinking about it. So, but yeah, my memory's not so good. Okay, so get back to this question, thankfully, it's still on the board. I think I can make the following statement, and people aren't going to argue with me that it is essential to have integral transforms if I'm going to say anything meaningful about derived categories of variety. Without this, it becomes quite difficult to attach any structure to an abstract equivalence of time. Okay.
I mean, since we're on this topic, it's worth mentioning that in positive characteristics, if you're DJ algorithms, there are triangulated unicorns.
Oh yeah. Well, is there examples where we have an equivalence and something that doesn't?
Triangulated equivalence, which is not an
what?
Equivalence of DJ values. It's not under Shifley, or
it's not an equivalence. Are we talking about
It's a category of type of like metric organization that are not related to the rights.
No, I understand. If one is making a list of examples, there are triangulated uniforms and positive characters.
This is a singularity category, like Z mod 4 and Z2 would join X mod X squared?
Yeah.
Too intense.
Huh?
Yes, too intense.
It's too intense. Yeah. So, but we're fortunate in the case of this, from work with once in a while, that we know we have a unique unit. And we'll use that here in a second. We just have to figure out what is the correct geometric setting to put a kernel into. Okay. And there's sort of obvious yeses for what that should be. And with enough assumptions on the rings, the obvious guess will turn out to be the correct guess. Albeit with describing this as a little bit more of a chore.
How am I doing?
You get to be involved.
Okay. All right. Okay, what's sort of the... So the obvious guess is the thing you would do if you take projective things and embed them in projective spaces. And then you just use the Segre embedding, right? Is that the right embedding? This is another thing that I put a question on my test about the Segre embedding, and then someone came in and asked a question about it, and I kept talking about the Veronese embedding for like 15 minutes. And they didn't interrupt me. And they didn't understand, yeah, so. I apologize to them and to everyone else. So what is this in terms of the action on greater rings? Well, we need to break down the natural bigrading on this. So with single grading, all we do is we just take the diagonal.
Are you telling us what the segregated product of graded algebras is?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I should really write definition. The segregated product of graded algebras is graded. But this is effectively, I mean, this is what you get from the segregated embedding. So you guess that this is the correct thing to do, but you need some finiteness assumptions in order to actually get that. So I will actually say definition here because I just want to do the hard thing. We say A satisfies chi naught if if for all I there exists a J naught such that I look at the degree zero extensions in homological degree I from K to IJ and they vanish as I twist by I references. Okay? So if you're bored for the last 10 minutes, just check that commutative thing satisfied with you. Okay, so that's the definition of chi naught. And then there's a notion of Vandenberg that this is called exponentness. That says that the dimension of the ungraded X groups in K to K is finite. As far as I know, maybe people are better than me, these are two independent but related conditions. And so, the statement then is, let A and B be connected graded. K algebras, K to a field, such that A and B are both left and right invariant. Not a great position to impose in my computer today. Not a pose when you're investigating problems related to non-commuter projected schemes. So they're not just things I pulled out of somewhere to engineer the state.
Does X finiteness doesn't follow from the Hilbert assumption? You have to choose some projective resolution of K.
Yes.
You just forget the greatest one and think X from K itself.
This?
Yeah,
this is just forget the gradient.
But A is connected to, just say the minimal resolution, this means that the minimal resolution is just finite. Right?
Okay.
Right? So K is perfect model of A, and it's actually good.
No. For a theory?
If not to finite resolution,
it's
infinite.
Yeah, it's possible. If you had that condition, the only example that I can think about like that are you looking for, say, uniform, the homogeneous quarter limit, where K is well behaved like that, it's going to be.
Yeah, and also some just again clarification. This assumption does follow that the picture of Huber is completely generated.
Under this assumption, I think
because that would be obvious if K is perfect, but if it's not, then you need some extra.
More or less like internal homotonic for some enhancement.
can make a general quasi error for just the bi-graded ring. That's the tensor product. So instead of demanding that you land in projective space, we have a single grade, this is rank one Picard group. Say, okay, we have rank two Picard group, two graded things. And then you can look at torsion as being torsion on one side, torsion on the other side, and anything that fits into an exact sequence with these on one side or the other. So it's the smallest thick subcategory generated by A and B torsion. Right? And so the main statement is that this under these assumptions, that this fits. Okay? And then once you have this, there's a result. I forgot to do this, I'm sorry. That says that if you have degree one generation, so this is not us, we just assume the Vandenberg. And you get quasi derivatives. So again, the key thing is, Sasha said, you want to know if this really is the tensor product of the 2D category. And the only, you know, in the commuter case, it's sort of so generators and tensor. Let me just finish my statement real quick and then bring up the questions. There's a bit of duality in here, right? Really, because you're on the commuter thing, you just take, you know, like opposite, you take endomorphisms, and then you do, you know, invert arrows, and you get it done. Here, you're taking a quotient, and then you're taking the opposite category. Or you're taking the opposite category and you're taking the quotient and maybe something else. And you want to make sure those two operations match up. And that's all that these guys guarantee. You need actually both of them to get that.
What does A tensor be?
Just the tensor. They're K-algebras, but it's a tensor product.
So it's A tensor
product.
It's
C-star square.
So it's by bi-graded.
Bi-graded.
So it's bi-graded.
Yeah, so maybe. Yeah. It's sort of the, you know. If I think about these as categories, right?
So which
is A and B is then somebody, so something
like
something.
Which
for
what?
What?
If they're generated in every one.
Yeah? This thing? Yeah.
Just,
I mean, that's a segregator embedding, just think of that.
Right.
So
in particular, B equals K, then there's a category of self-public.
Yeah, that's part of it.
Yeah, that's kind of surprising.
Well, yes. There's a, this list is, I mean, I had to look like, we call this a tasty pair, just to give it a name. But it's, you know, it's hopefully Blake will pare this down a bit and say what's actually needed. Okay, anyway, I'll just stop. Thank you very much.
More questions?
The fact that the group was shared on this itself, so I think it's a little bit of a wonderful thing.
For X-Men?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
You defined the projective non-commutative scheme associated with matrix. But there are degenerate cases where the resulting quotient algebra will be infinite dimensional.
Yeah.
For example, for simplicity n equal to 0, if A, that is a 1 by 1 matrix, equals to 1, then your relation is trivial.
Yes.
And should it be thought of as a projective thing? Is it a projectivization if your thing just an algebra of polynomials of one variable?
No, that's a very good thing. Usually when you deal with these situations, you have some control over the growth, the rate of growth of the graded pieces, right? When I have a polynomial ring, I know how fast homogeneous polynomials grow with respect to order. If I count the dimension of the spaces, I know how that grows with respect to whatever the factorial expression is of homogeneous polynomials. So, usually when this is done, at least when the real algebraic non-commutative algebraics do it, is they put a restriction on the rate of growth, the Gerlafon-Kirlhoff dimension of this non-commutative algebra. And then they say, well, it's actually an integer, and
study surfaces. If it's two, you study, you know, higher dimensional things. When it's larger than two. So whether it, I mean, whether it should be called projective, yeah, probably not. You probably want to put some control on this growth already to say something meaningful.
So not any matrix A is good.
Well, I mean, it fit my definition, but it's not necessarily a good thing to look at in papers. Definition isn't violated by what I wrote down, right? But whether it behaves similarly enough to a projective scheme, okay, that's a different question. And that, no, that's you want to have some control over the matrix, in particular, how large the ring itself is.
So, just a remark about that. There was a paper by Kalamata and Stellaria on the uniqueness of these constants. They proved that it's unique for Grothendieck category of the Grothendieck category. As a consequence, that result is true for any Noetherian scheme with enough local equations.
Okay, thank you.
So, I mean, they proved the enhancement is unique, and the model enhancement is unique, of course, you can... The
no, it was proved by Valera that it's enough for Noetherian scheme with enough local equations. So, I mean, they proved a little bit more.
Yeah, they proved a little bit more, but...
Yeah, but I mean that it's not necessary.
Just it's super more than just voice questions.
That's good to have experts in the audience.
What is it?